Welcome, everyone. This is the first discussion of the series Uncensored Conversations, promoting open and critical discussion around COVID-19 and its consequences, which is set up by Decolonial Subversions, a newly established open access and multilingual publishing platform that is dedicated to Western epistemology and bridging knowledge production with societal issues. I am Dr. Romina Istratii. I'm actually currently a senior teaching fellow at SOAS and also co-founder of Decolonial Subversions with Monica Hirmer. And my research applies a decolonial perspective to gender and development in order to promote community-centered and culture-sensitive approaches to development in sub-Saharan Africa. I'm Eastern European by origin, born in Moldova and raised in Greece, and I currently live in the UK due to my work, so I'm also non-local. The outbreak of COVID-19 has generated a lot of discussion, fueling what seems to be increasing polarization and deterioration, perhaps, of healthy dialogue, both in understanding the science around SARS-CoV-2, so the severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, and to deciding appropriate responses to it. We believe that this lack of dialogical process we've observed has combined actually with increasing unaccountable government decisions and information dissemination, problematic liaisons and overlaps between bureaucrats, epistemics, and capitalists, the encroachment of high techs in public health data collection, and increasingly noticeable socioeconomic disparities. We would like, through this series, to reflect on these issues and ask the more fundamental questions, the more ethical, philosophical, and social scientific questions that haven't received as much attention in the epidemiological and medical discussions so far. And we hope to do so by inviting specialized thinkers from across the world in order to explore some of these themes together, openly and critically, in an exploratory manner. We are glad to be starting the series with a discussion on the reported disproportionate deaths in ethnic minority groups here in the UK, but also in the US for those who are following the news. As a result of this emerging data, actually, Public Health England has already issued an inquiry into the matter. And the latest report has stated, quote, after accounting for differences in age, sex, and geography, Black Caribbean deaths are 1.7 times those of white British. Pakistani deaths are 2.7 times as high, and Black African fatalities 3.5 times higher. Minority groups have also seen excess mortality, close quote. These findings have obviously triggered new conversations, new inquiries into the factors around this disparity, and deeper conversations around not only the health-related variables, but also the structural and socioeconomic variables that might have led to this outcome. So I have invited today Professor Raj Bhopal, who is Emeritus Professor of Public Health at the University of Edinburgh. Raj was born in India, brought up in Glasgow, and studied medicine in Edinburgh University. His books include Concepts of Epidemiology, Migration, Ethnicity, Race, and Health, and Epidemic of Cardiovascular Disease and Diabetes, Explaining the Phenomenon in South Asians Worldwide. Raj, welcome. It is a pleasure to have you with us today. We look forward to the conversation with you.
Thank you, Romina. I'm delighted to be here. Sounds very interesting.
Thank you so much. And you were just telling me that there aren't many opportunities to have this kind of conversations, because obviously the kind of requests you get in your email are mostly medical and public health related. So thank you so much for honoring us with this this opportunity to ask you questions.
Thank you.
So I thought to start with, because again, the audience, our public, might not be versed in these matters and statistics. Can I invite you to discuss a bit these statistics, these emerging statistics, and what are some of the explanations that have been given for these disparities? Where do these data come from? What data do we rely on to draw these conclusions? And are these data comprehensive, and sufficiently reliable, or do we need more work?
Right. Let me start by saying that In epidemiology, we study the pattern of diseases in populations. And we like to subgroup our populations. We break them down into age groups, into sex groups. We don't tend to use gender. We tend to use sex as a variable. And we like to use ethnic group in the UK. In Europe, they like to use migrant status. And in the United States, they like to use race. So I'm going to stick with the concept of ethnicity. So we like to look what's happening in terms of the population, what's the impact of the disease in various subgroups of the population. And by comparing and contrasting, we learn something, not just about how to mount a public health response. For example, we know this disease hits the old very hard, so the public health response needs to be geared towards the older people. But we also learn something about causation and explanations as to why it's behaving in this particular way. So if we take first principles of public health and epidemiology, we know that diseases hit the poor much harder than they hit the well-off. There's only a couple of diseases which hit the well-off harder than the poor. This has been known for hundreds of years, and quantitatively for at least 150 years. With numerous reports. We also know that there are major variations in the pattern of diseases across different ethnic groups. And we have a lot of research from the UK in particular, a lot of research from the United States, but mounting amounts of research from across the world. So we, for any disease, we do expect to find ethnic variations. Now for this particular disease, COVID-19, what would we expect to find even without data? I think that's a very important question to ask. What do we expect to find first principles? Forget the data for the moment. Well, we know that infections like this, viral infections, they occur in overcrowded places. They occur where people are poor. They occupy small amounts of space with large numbers of people. They may be working in crowded conditions. We wouldn't expect them in people living in salubrious parts of the country. In large homes, perhaps working from home, we wouldn't expect this disease to hit such people very hard. So on first principles, we would expect some of the ethnic minority populations, wherever they are, to be hit harder than the population as a whole, because by and large, ethnic minority groups occupy the lower social strata. That's just a fact of life for virtually all ethnic minority groups across the whole world. And I think there are a few exceptions, like, for example, in the UK, I think it's reasonable to say that Indian people in the UK have done quite well over since their arrival over the last 50 years. And they're occupying a social stratum, which is virtually the same as the population as a whole. That's not true for Bangladeshis. It's not true for Pakistanis. It's not true for African origin population. It's not true for Chinese populations either. So we would expect them to be harder hit in terms of the amount of disease occurring, and that's clearly true. They are being harder hit in terms of their chances of getting COVID-19. Yes. Now, the real surprise has been not so much that they're harder hit in that respect, because it's true for the poorer populations as well. No, for the poorer white populations, they're also harder hit. I think the real surprise is that once they get the infection, the outcomes are worse. Now, so I'm going to take a pause here just in case at this point something is not clear.
No, this is very interesting, and I want to give you the proper time to develop your point, obviously. But, you know, obviously there's also the factor of who works in health and care jobs and positions, yes. Right? And obviously a large number of ethnic minority background individuals occupy these positions, various strata of these positions, both senior management and lower ranks, correct? Well,
thank you for making that point for me, Romina. You've made it very well. I mean, in addition to living in relatively overcrowded conditions, they're also doing the essential worker roles, the public-facing roles, where they're in contact with people. Whereas a chief executive of a large company might have his or her own office, and they limit who they're meeting. People on the factory floor they don't have that option. They're not in their own private office. They might be in a shared office if they're office workers, or they might be on a shop floor. They might have to be serving the customers. So they're meeting a lot of people. They're working in the taxi trade or public transport. As you said, the health workers, the care workers, many of them are from minorities, and especially the care worker workforce.
Absolutely.
So that explains why they're at higher risk.
Absolutely. And, you know, I did a bit of work with Ethiopian and Eritrean communities here in the UK, and a lot of my participants, I was doing ethnographic research, were telling me that some of the jobs they were trying to get in order to achieve some sort of stability were mostly care jobs, because it was slightly easier to get that training and qualification. So it's also lack of options. It might be the best option, you know, it really depends on their conditions, on their life circumstances as well, their age as well, and what kind of work they can do at that age, correct? So it's really important to consider the overall conditions of that community. And this actually brings us back to your point that it's important to consider, you know, pre-existing health conditions, for example, or comorbidities, as you've, you know, thoroughly addressed in your book, you know, around cardiovascular diseases. And so do you want to walk us through a bit on those comorbidities?
Yes. And just before I go on to that, I will come to that shortly, because we start to talk about explanations. Let's just talk about data.
Okay.
Data is a complex matter. All over the world, countries will have a principle that their data systems should allow them to understand the health of subpopulations. But apart from age and sex, very few countries have got good health systems. And even for sex, you study gender, you know that very often data are not even analyzed by age. Never mind, they're not even analyzed by age and sex, never mind by other variables. Gender, we don't tend to collect in the health system. I mean, we don't collect gender in the census, we don't collect gender in our healthcare systems.
Yes, we
collect the variable sex. So data systems tend to be very poor. In the UK, we have taken pride that we have paid attention to the variable ethnicity, country of birth, and religion. These variables are in our census. They've been in the census since 1991. And to some extent, they're in our healthcare systems as well. So in the data sets for our healthcare system, partly there, country of birth is on the death certificate. Ethnicity is on the death certificate in Scotland, but not in England.
Not in England, yes.
Religion is not on any death certificate. The truth is that despite some 25 years of quite firm governmental policy, our healthcare systems to analyze data by ethnicity are very weak. So we have spent a lot of time and effort to collect these data. They're in the hospital data sets. They're partly in primary care data sets. And the quality of the data and the amount of analysis done them is so small that we can't even say that they're reliable. They can't. They should be providing data at the touch of a button, but they don't. The best data we have in the UK come from Scotland, as often is the case. Scotland tends to be a bit of a world leader when it comes to data. And in Scotland, we have the Scottish Health and Ethnicity Linkage Study, where we linked the census 2001 to hospitalization, mortality, and a number of other databases, including breast cancer screening, bowel cancer screening, various things. And we are able to produce, through individualized data linkage, health outcomes. So for example, we have published on respiratory infections, including influenza, by ethnic group in Scotland. Those data are, and on a vast other range of other outcomes. And we've been saying to people across the world, particularly England, why don't you do the same thing? But sometimes things happen in one place because of some local context, the politicians who are there, or the chief medical officer, or the academics that are there, or there's a drive to do something and it happens. In other places, the same thing could happen, but it doesn't happen. So I would say the data systems are very weak in the UK, despite a lot of effort. And when we say we want to get data on COVID-19 by ethnic group, it's easy to say and very hard to do.
Absolutely. And if I may add to this, because it was meant to be a question actually for you, so I'm glad that you moved in that direction about what makes a political decision, you know, what kind of incentive must there be for policy to be informed by public health concerns. So in Scotland, you know, the ethnicity is mentioned in the death certificate. In England, this hasn't happened. I was wondering, is this a failure, I guess, or a lack of conduits for public health specialists to be informing policy? What does your experience teach you about this? You know, why is it that these systems, right, the health systems, are not responding to these needs as fast as they could, as you're suggesting?
Well, let's take this very important question. In 1991, the Department of Health in England said that ethnicity was going to be collected, and it was going to be collected in primary care, general practice. So they issued guidance to the healthcare system there. It didn't work. It's too hard. Herding general practitioners is a bit like herding cats. It's very difficult to do. It failed. So in 1995, they said, well, it was 1994, the executive letter was written and the policy was to be enacted in 1995. And ethnicity was to be collected in hospitals. So they had a good go at this, many years. Nothing great happened. No publications, no routine reports. Then we had the Race Relations Amendment Act 2000, enacted in 2002. Suddenly, health services and all public agencies were required to promote equality and actively promote equality. And to demonstrate that they were promoting equality, so to demonstrate it, you needed data. The Commission for Racial Equality were getting edgy. That's what it was called then. And they were asking the health service what's going on. And the answer was, we tend to collect data in England. Probably collection was up to about 60%, but no one was analyzing it because you can't analyze data when only 60% completeness or 70% completeness. You have to get up to about 90% completeness. In Scotland, we were up to about 10% completeness, although the ethnic code was about highly recommended. It wasn't mandatory. In England, it was mandatory. So with the prodding of the Commission for Racial Equality, Scottish Government, the health boards, the health authorities started taking action in Scotland. And since then, we've got up to about 70, 80% completeness. And in December 2019, we published the very first analyses of hospitalization in Scotland by ethnic group. And we showed that a good effort had been made, and some of the data makes sense, some of the data don't make sense, but a lot more work is required so that we can get data routinely. In England, there's been a few smattering of publications, mainly around cancer, but the data systems are not that great, to be absolutely honest. They're not bad. And the reason they're not that great is because there's not enough rigorous analysis. For any data system, you have to rigorously analyze, you have to learn what's good about the system, what's not so good, and then you have to work hard to improve it. Right, so what is it that about Scotland that happened? This is a very interesting question. It's not the first time I've reflected on it, I've spoken about this. How come Scotland was so far behind England in 1999? And by now, it's so far ahead of England. Hard to believe. Although, and I think it is about people. Who's there? Who's pushing? What's going on? When I arrived in Edinburgh in 1999, I came from Newcastle, and I reported here to Scotland that Scotland was at least 10 years behind England in respect to this issue of data collection by ethnic group. The Race Relations Amendment Act was being prepared. People knew it was being prepared. And our health ministers had made lofty speeches about all the things that were going to happen, which of course didn't happen. They can come up with their statements, but unless the people on the ground take them seriously and they have the resources to take them seriously, it doesn't happen. So not much was happening. And I pointed out to the health minister, who had made this lofty speech a few years back, that nothing had happened.
And I guess, Raj, because this is an important question, we want to, it runs through the questions we're asking in this series of what is the role of this scientific community, people like you and myself, not in my respective domains, of course, what kind of role do we have in policymaking and in pushing for these decisions to be made? And how can we then become more efficient in that effort? Because I think you're quite active. It seems to me that you're very active, pushing for good things to happen. What have you learned from your experience? What is our role? How can we make that?
Our role is to point out what needs to be done. Mm-hmm. We can't do everything, but the one job we do need to do is point out what needs to be done, what needs to be improved, what needs to be repaired, and to bring people together. We are in mm-hmm. a unique position.
Yes.
I had a honorary consultant contract with the NHS, so had my responsibilities there as well. Plus, I was a professor of public health at the University of Edinburgh. So it's like a very good position, it has to be said. People knew who I was, I knew who people were. Scotland's a small country. I'm mm-hmm. in Edinburgh, I know the politicians, I know the senior civil servants, I know the managers. Mm-hmm. It's been easy for them to get to know me. And I know the chief medical officers. So I started to point out what needed to be done. Mm-hmm. And we held a seminar with the Information Services Division. And one of the senior researchers there said to me, I can solve your problem by linking the census to the Community Health Index, which is the NHS's index mm. of patients. And I said, then we can spend the next 25 years in jail, Chris. That was his name, Chris Pobey, the late Chris Pobey. He was a brilliant man. Mm. I miss him. And he said, well, we could maybe try and do it anonymously. Anyway, we tried many other methods in Scotland because we'd got a grant to try and improve Scottish data systems. Mm-hmm. And we realized that every other effort we tried had many severe limitations. So we went back to Chris Povey's idea. We spent about 6 months brainstorming it. How would we make it happen legally, including mm-hmm. getting the Registrar General for Scotland involved, the Chief Medical Officer involved, one of the senior civil servants involved, Public Health Scotland yeah. involved, many other colleagues. It took about a year of consultation plus setting out a system for making this ethical. Mm-hmm. And we eventually got all the permissions, including from Chief Medical Officer and other people, that to respond to the Race Relations Amendment Act, there was mm-hmm. no other way but to link the census. So the Registrar General said he had a legal duty to use the census data for statistical purposes. You can't release individual data for 100 years, but for mm-hmm. statistical purposes, you can release it. So we devised a very secure, anonymized system. All the data had to be analyzed at the offices of the census people, NRS, and nothing could be taken out until it was cleared statistically. And we produced these data. So how does it happen? How does this kind of thing happen? I think it happens by people who want to do something, who have mm-hmm. a vision, and yes. who can bring people together to solve problems, and who can raise the grants. That's one of the benefits of being an academic. You have to raise grants.
Well, absolutely. Grants. And we through this platform, we do want to push for more an active role in a scholarship and in academia to bridge, yeah. again, societal problems and challenges with knowledge production. Exactly. Yeah. And
so in Scotland, we've got this study, and when I returned in 2018, the study's been put on ice. Mm. And that's what happens when the grants run out, things go on ice. We've published all the papers, we have a website, and people keep on saying we need to resurrect this, and maybe with COVID-19 it will be resurrected because it's the obvious way to do it. I've been trying to want to do it, and so I think the answer is you need a confluence of mm-hmm. people, ideas. This wouldn't have happened without this ad hoc seminar that we had with Information Services Division in Scotland. It was about yes. the year 2000. Our academic department had this seminar with this service organization, mm-hmm. and this maverick, brilliant maverick, Chris Povey, said he could do it for us. And it seemed so outlandish. It seemed mm-hmm. illegal, impossible. But we made what seemed impossible possible. So mm-hmm. with technical people like him, with people like the Chief Medical Officer in support, many mm-hmm. people in support, with my public health colleagues, I suppose I was the academic leader that made it happen, leading on writing the grants, leading on the communications, great research fellows, always need someone who makes it happen, as it were, who brings people together to make things happen, sets up the team. We had also had this situation of the great promises by politicians which had not been delivered on. I had them. I had the I had their speeches. Someone had sent me the speeches, so I knew what had been said and I could quote from them. And I was able to point out to the new health minister that the promises in the speeches
were not kept. Well, listening to you, I absolutely agree with what you're saying. From my experience, that you need vision and people to drive this, absolutely, and you need spaces to communicate, to bring the different stakeholders together and have that convergence happen. On the other hand, you know, we're seeing the SAGE committee and how this has been worked, has been working, and you know, we all raised questions of transparency around it. And again, whose science matters? Who is it that is informing the policy? Because it has been in some cases a bit arbitrary. So not each study has had the same weight or has been assessed with the same weight. And then you see how people's relations actually inform science and policy making. And I think there is that danger of, again, not having a dialogical decision making of which science, which scientific evidence are we going to trust and rely on to move forward, right? Because again, there's multiple studies, multiple diverse points of view, and all studies need to be considered. You know, with equal weight, and see which one then makes more sense in that condition to follow. And I'm thinking again from on the basis of the study that Neil Ferguson led, you know, was Imperial College, and then the Oxford study, which had a very different model, and you know, the decision making seemed to have been made on the first study, leading to the current lockdown. So I'm thinking of these dynamics and how decision making was made and how the response then was decided by the UK government and many other governments. It makes me consider and think again, whose science matters, you know, and how can we make that conversation between the multiple stakeholders more democratic, more dialogical and inclusive, and have everyone feed that conversation. I hope that this makes sense to you. You're looking at me in doubt.
No, I'm not looking at you in doubt. I think we might digress from the focus of our discussion, which is on ethnicity. And
we do.
But yes. There's no harm in digressing for a moment. This is not the first pandemic. Mm-hmm. This is not the first massive outbreak that we've ever had. People keep on saying it's new. We don't know mm-hmm. anything about it. That's nonsense. Yes. We've been dealing with worldwide pandemics for as long as human history has been recorded, and the public health field has been doing them. One of the first principles of public health is, as soon as the pandemic or epidemic is identified, you set mm-hmm. up your epidemic control committee next morning. Mm-hmm. We should have been setting up our pandemic control committee on the day the WHO told the world that there was this infection in Wuhan, China. Mm-hmm. It should have been set up then, and the chairperson should have been announced, the composition of the committee should be announced then. Mm-hmm. There should have been a daily press conference from then, from January. I said this to my wife before SAGE was set up.
Yes.
We know this because I've taught this to my students for 35 years. When I was involved in the Glasgow Legionnaires disease outbreak, it was recognized one evening. Next morning, the epidemic control team was assembled. Mm. That's how things are supposed to work. Not a secretive committee that we don't even know the membership of.
Precisely.
And we don't see the evidence that they're using.
Yes. And to add, some names have been released for those who gave consent. If you go on the Gov UK page, but not everyone gave consent, so let's note that. And there's also the question of who is included in that committee, because I think I've gone through the names, and it struck me that the social scientists were much fewer than, you know, obviously, and it makes sense to have epidemiologists and medical experts. But you know, the crisis raises a lot of social scientific questions as well, and you know, you've pointed to some of them that we learn by experience, so we kind of know the kind of questions that need to be asked every time there is a new epidemiological crisis. And many of these questions are informed again by socioeconomic realities, essentially. So you know, there's broad, bigger questions here of how do we respond, of responses, which probably, you know, have to deal with again, the UK government and how it functions. But because this is another conversation that we hope to have in the future, I would like us to return a bit to the category ethnic minority. Yeah. These are brilliant points, and we will take them and follow, you know.
Let's return, before we return, the point is the WHO was giving guidance, other countries were responding. Mm. Taiwan had responded, Singapore had responded, South Korea had responded. They had taken it very seriously. New Zealand was responding.
Yes.
Why were we not responding? Where were we? Mm. Who was sleeping in January? Yeah. That's when we should have been alert, not in March. Mm. It was too late. In my view, and in view of many other people, the pandemic was already here in January. Yes. Probably it was here in December. Mm-hmm. And we seem to be sleeping on the job in January.
Mm.
But let's return to where we were. Yes. And let's start with maybe, come back to migrants, because...
Well, may I start, Raj, just a quick question on the category of ethnic minority, because, you know, as an anthropologist, when I read these population studies by the Office of National Statistics and, you know, the review, the IFS Deaton review on the disproportionate deaths and so forth, I see how they use certain classifications, and I find them frustrating because they're quite broad. They're quite uniform, and obviously these groups and communities are non-monolithic, very different to, you know, across these communities. So I know you've problematized the concept of ethnicity. You problematized it in relation to the concept of race, and you know, you think that ethnicity is a better working definition, if that makes sense. Do you want to speak on that a bit, and you know, the problem of conceptualization and classification, and how do we work around it?
Well, as individuals, we observe people around us. Mm-hmm. I observe you, you observe me. When people observe me, they immediately know that I'm not Scottish, of Scottish mm-hmm. ancestry, and they want to know what my background is. And they get very confused because they hear a Scottish accent, but they see someone that doesn't look like their view of what a Scotsman is like.
Yes.
So people ask questions, and our brains are large for that particular reason, because we're a social species, mm-hmm. and we have to hold information about people. That's mm-hmm. why our brains are big, and we're social animals. So, and we organize the way we think about people in a number of ways: sex, gender, mm-hmm. Age, ethnicity is one. Now we didn't always have the concept of ethnicity. It's mm. relatively new. But we have had for a very long time the concept of race. Mm. And that's when people were organized or described or classified according to physical features, biological features. And that concept has actually weakened in the last 70 years since the Second World War, because of the atrocities around that concept. It's still very much alive in the United States and some other parts of the world. Mm-hmm. In the UK, we've moved to ethnicity, and in Europe, they just use the concept of migrant status. So what is ethnicity? According to certainly the epidemiological or public health perspective, because it's obviously a complex concept, mm-hmm. is the group that you belong to or are perceived to belong to as a result of a number of features which are largely cultural, mm-hmm. but not solely cultural. They're also to do with ancestry and background and indeed color mm-hmm. and physical features. So I'm Indian. I was born to Indian parents. I was brought up in a Punjabi traditional way. Mm-hmm. I eat Indian food. I speak Indian languages. My religion is Indian. I look Indian, although I also look Middle Eastern, because when I go to the Middle East, people think I'm just local. So for a number of reasons, I'm Indian. My name is Indian. Mm. And people can recognize it straight away. And people think of me as Indian. So I think of myself as Indian, and people see me as Indian too. That kind of thinking can be brought to a population level. And through discussion with people, We've learned that there's no point just assigning people into an ethnic group. That doesn't work. Yeah. But if you ask people which ethnic group they're in, it works reasonably well. And in the UK, we've done a lot of research to try and devise classifications that work for people. Mm. And the classifications we use in our censuses, starting in 1991, they've been heavily researched. Usually tens of thousands of people have been involved in developing these classifications, ordinary people being asked about what they're comfortable with, how they see themselves and how others see them. And the classification we have in the UK, although it's, from your perspective, it might not seem very sophisticated, and it's not, it's one of the most sophisticated classifications in the whole world. And you might want to compare it with some of the classifications in European countries, for example. We have done this. We have we have compared the classifications in large numbers of countries across the world. So I can tell you from our published work and work with various organizations, we've got one of the most sophisticated classifications of ethnicity in the world. And by and large, it works because people are willing to answer the question. Ordinary people find the questions intuitive and they're willing to answer them, and they can find a place for themselves in that classification. It's not true.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I do think it's a quite refined classification, so multiple, more categories. And I think it reflects also the multicultural make of UK society, obviously. But, you know, it also tends certain categories. Again, when I have to take a census and I see the white category, it is just so broad that it simply groups people together. Eastern Europeans are nothing like Western Europeans. And I think that this is a broad dichotomy that one can actually draw on the basis of history, East and West, in this particular geography. For instance, in the IFS review, I was looking at the white other category because I was looking for the Eastern migrants, the Eastern European migrants in the UK, but they didn't seem to be captured in that specific study because the white other was referring to Gypsy and Irish traveler groups. And so I wondered, well, aren't Eastern European migrants, I've been a migrant in Greece coming from Moldova, an economic migrant, aren't they being captured? Aren't they vulnerable, potentially vulnerable group? Not everyone is vulnerable. People are very resilient. But, you know, shouldn't they also be included in a study of ethnic minorities in the UK? I might be wrong. This is my reading of the study and the categories. But, you know, it's just one, I guess, response to it as somebody
The answer to your question is yes, if it's practicable. In 1991, we had a much simpler classification than we have now. In 2001, it was improved and enlarged. In 2011, the white population was disaggregated into several groups. In 2021, it's going to be different again. So the number of categories keeps on increasing. If there's a case for a particular Eastern European group, and there is a very strong case for the Polish population, because the Polish population
I
think is going to be separated.
Yes.
That's the way it works, but someone has to make a case. Currently, there's people making a case for Sikhs to be in the ethnic group classification and not just in the religion classification. So people are trying to make their cases. In Scotland, there was a very strong case for removing the word black from the classification, and there was a strong lobby and went to Parliament and parliamentary discussions. So you know this as a social scientist, that it's change occurs not just because of some sort of logical reason, but because of advocacy.
Precisely, exactly.
And,
which emphasizes your point that, you know, we have to take an active role in these conversations. Yes. You know, everyone needs to be able to participate and share their knowledge and share their viewpoint in a dialogical manner, hopefully so as to improve these systems, the health systems. And this sort of, now that I said health systems and thinking of the broader picture, you know, there's a lot of discussion about the socioeconomic inequalities and how these have made certain groups more susceptible to the risk of the virus and, you know, more vulnerable. Based on your experience, what would you say are the most salient links between health and economic, you know, financial precariousness that we need to consider, not just in this crisis, because as you say, we've had multiple crises before, but proactively, you know, there are certain groups, including white minority, you know, students,
yes,
from the white majority. I've been a student, I'm white, but I struggled, you know, couldn't meet the rent monthly. And I see, you know, current students in the supermarkets who were currently, you know, during the pandemic, because they have to, because they need that rent. So obviously economic precariousness is a huge issue. Why do we have to wait until a public health crisis happens to realize this or to address it? And you're smiling because obviously this is a question that you thought about.
Yeah,
and believe that is key. You know, what can we do more to consider, you know, to be proactive about these issues? Isn't, let me know if I'm wrong in this, shouldn't it be part of public health to consider how to make more economically resilient, people more economically resilient, because that is, it correlates directly with health, right, and risk and susceptibility to crises. So shouldn't that socioeconomic analysis be part of health research and debates, or is this something that is happening already, since I'm not in that discipline and I'm not aware?
No, I think the answer is it is the number one priority of public health, and it has been the number one priority of public health ever since it was established and as a specialty in the 19th century. The first medical officer of health of Edinburgh, Sir Henry Littlejohn, his first report in 1865 pointed out the vast differences in mortality rates across the city of Edinburgh, and the explanations for them, the poverty and the poor housing, etc. And in his first report, he said, we have to demolish most of Edinburgh, or much of Edinburgh, because people can't live healthy lives here. Amazingly enough, his first report was largely about how to change the architecture of the city. And it's been a number one priority in public health ever since. And you'll have heard of the Michael Marmot reports, the Social Determinants of Health project of the WHO that Michael Marmot has been leading. So in fact, if you look at the literature of public health, probably about half of the literature is about inequalities in health, and especially socioeconomic inequalities in health.
Right.
And it's that intersection between socioeconomic inequalities in health and migrant status and ethnicity that perhaps we're trying to focus on today.
Absolutely.
Because there's a compounding of effects. Well, you'll know all about intersectionality. That's a sort of a social science issue.
You're forcing me to move into the next question, because I did prepare to ask you.
Public health also deals with intersectionality, and epidemiology does too, but we don't call it intersectionality. We haven't called it intersectionality. We think of it more as a sort of correlation between different
variables,
factors.
Essentially. Absolutely.
Variables, yeah.
And this is precisely what I was thinking of proposing in our conversation, of perhaps the need to take a more ethnographic sort of microscopic approach to these communities, you know, because oftentimes with population studies, again, we have to use general categories, absolutely, but we miss the diversity within the category. Obviously, you know, the ethnic minorities that we've discussed have been affected differently. I think the Black Caribbean group has been particularly hit. There's differentials within these larger categories, and I think we
absolutely
need to be aware of that. And this brings me slowly to our sort of last set of questions about migration and migrants, because we focused mostly on sort of local ethnic minority groups, but obviously there's a large population of migrants, children of migrants. I think you've sort of debunked, or you're not very keen on the term second generation and third generation and fourth generation migrants.
Well, definitely not. That's just illogical.
Yes.
I mean, you can call them second generation, but you can't call them second generation migrants. They're not migrants any longer.
Which is used though, right? I've seen it quite extensively.
Yes. A lot of illogical stuff happens.
Absolutely. And you see, I was raised in Greece. I didn't consider myself a migrant ever. I never used that term. I use it actually now being in the UK when I describe my life's narrative. But when I was there living my life in the community, I never considered myself different than the locals. You know, I've described myself as Greek in the mentality and cultural background. So you know, it probably makes little sense, especially from the ethnographic perspective, from the perspective of the person and the lived experience. And I wanted us to talk a little bit about migrant populations here in the UK.
Yeah.
You've also suggested, that the government could perhaps grant temporary citizenship to undocumented migrants, which is, the most, vulnerable category currently because they can't access health services. So granting them temporary citizenship would mean that they can access healthcare without fear of repercussion. That's my understanding. How is this something that is being considered currently? Are there different propositions on how to, to address, to approach this group and support them?
Very much so. I'm going to start with a very broad perspective first, because I think when you, migration is the most important thing that ever happened to humanity. It underpins all the success of our species. I mean, it's been estimated by biologists that there should be about 50,000 humans on the earth. We've got 7 billion. We've been so successful. All that success has been driven by migration. Firstly, local migration. Secondly, international migration. And migration is a very good thing if you look at it from a human history point of view and the development of populations. So why there should be so much negativity around migration in the modern era, it's pretty unclear, because it wasn't always thus. People have been migrating and traveling all over the world for thousands of years without passports, without visas, and they somehow or other managed. Okay, the world has changed, I'll have to admit it. But we have to think of migration as being a really good thing for most societies. It creates intermingling, it creates vigor in societies, cultural vigor, genetic vigor. The worst, it's called hybrid vigor. All biologists know about it. It's you can't have inbreeding. It's the worst thing for any society. So it's a very good thing to have migration. Now, when people are trying to migrate, some of them are so motivated, so desperate, so motivated to improve their lives that they'll store themselves away in dangerous places. They'll cross thousands of miles across the seas. And these people are highly motivated, energetic, usually young men. And we treat them very badly. And when it comes to normal society, people are always going on about illegal, so-called illegal, I won't call them, that's the wrong terminology, undocumented irregular migrants. They're always going on about them. They're always in the newspapers. But when we have to do something like now, suddenly, there don't seem to be any. Previously, there seemed to be estimates of somewhere between 100,000 and a million. And now there don't seem to be any because no one's talking about them. Why is that? Because we know we have to deliver services to them. Well, I've been digging behind the scenes, and I know that actually quite a lot of changes have been made to the regulations and the advice coming from the Home Office to the charitable sector and to local authorities, but it's not been made public.
Oh, interesting.
Very well hidden. Because I don't know why. I would like to ask the Priti Patel why these things have been kept largely secret. Well, it's in our interest to actually look after every single person in the country. We have to look after the homeless. We can't have them begging in front of the supermarkets, because there's a danger to the people going into the supermarkets, a danger to themselves, of course. And all the other people who are very poor, we need to look after them. And by and large, I would say in Scotland, we have looked after them, because I've probably walked a couple of hundred miles around the city centre of Edinburgh. Normally, I'd expect to see about 50 beggars every time I go for a walk. And in that time, I only saw about four until about a week ago. And now they're coming back onto the streets. And it's not right, because this pandemic is not going away. It's going to be with us for years. And we have to be incredibly careful. We have to look after the people for their own sake. We have to look after them for our sake.
Yes,
we can't coming outbreaks.
Yes, and this is absolutely, it's a reasonable point. It's a sensible point that you need to be aware of, the different groups in your population. You need to again, if you're a government, you need to be able to ensure public health. And public health means being aware of, again, these interactions between the different groups, as I understand. But at the same time, thinking of possible strategies to integrate these community better. Obviously granting citizenship could make health services accessible, but then there is the question of whether they would resort to these resources, because as you know, there is a structural and behavioral element to seeking healthcare in among the migrant community, but also ethnic minority groups. I know, again, having done some ethnographic work, that a lot of, for instance, on domestic violence, what I specialize in, a lot of victims will, most victims will tend to remain secret, you know, secretive about it, and will not seek support in the, what they might consider the secular mainstream sort of main state-led health system. They might resort to community elders or clergy or various other support systems that they might have within their community and religious cultural background.
Yes, Romina. That's precisely why we need to do something, because people are secretive. They're not they're scared of authorities. They're fearful about what might happen. And as a result, they're not going to come forward. Currently, under the emergency public health legislation, people people who are undocumented can access services for COVID-19 and the complications of COVID-19, but they can't access services for their diabetes. That's illogical. Firstly, if they've got diabetes and they get COVID-19, they're going to have a very bad reaction. Secondly, it just doesn't make sense to me that they can access for COVID-19, but they can't access for diabetes or a heart attack or something. Mm-hmm. Well, they could for a heart attack, it's an emergency. Secondly, they have no recourse to public funds. But currently in this emergency, local authorities have been told that where people have no recourse to public funds, they can have some recourse to resources as under the emergency legislation. So some limited loosening has taken place, but I've had to dig very hard to get that information. It's not been obvious where to get it from, but I have got it now. But it's not enough.
Do share, please, and we can disseminate if,
yes,
if it's publicly available.
Yes, it is publicly available, not easily available.
But this
I have shared some of it in. I have shared some of it in with the ethnic health list, as you know. And people have shared with me. So I did put some of it together. But anyway, to come back to this, some limited work is being done, but it's not enough. Firstly, we can't have people in large refugee centers or detention centers. Admittedly, people have to who are a danger to the public, they have to be kept separately, whether they're in prisons or whether they're in detention centers or whatever. But currently, deportation and that kind of thing is not really practical and feasible, given the circumstances we're in. We have a changed world, and we have to recognize that. Now, periodically, governments have granted amnesty to people who are undocumented. We haven't talked about an amnesty for a long time. It's time to maybe speak about it. Portugal has gone a long way already to doing this. They have taken steps to issue work permits to everyone who is applying for asylum. And I believe, but I haven't got, people have told me this, but I haven't got the evidence that hard evidence that they're actually doing the same with undocumented migrants. And across the world, people are beginning to speak about these populations. In India, one of the ministers of state said, please, migrants, please don't go back to your villages and homes. We need you here. And we're going to look after you. We're going to feed you and go to pay you to just to stay. So people are beginning to change their minds. And it seems a bit odd that we're flying in fruit pickers from Romania.
Yes, absolutely.
To great hazard to themselves, when we probably have large numbers of fruit pickers in the country who are currently undocumented. So if we're going to ask them to come forward, we have to give them reassurances that we'll look after them, that we will not be unfair to them, we will not be unjust to them. We'll give them a chance to speak and tell us why they should stay. And some of them will perform great services and they will earn their citizenship. So I think we do need a brand new thinking. We're in a brand new world. And this idea that we're suddenly going to get a vaccine and everything's going back to normal, it's just not true. I mean, if we do get a vaccine, it's going to take years. And the vaccine is going to take many years to demonstrate that this vaccine is safe for children and young people, where this virus is not very dangerous for young people and children.
Absolutely. So, yeah.
We're not going to return to some normal world for a long time.
Yes, and you're pointing, the whole conversation has pointed to these structural issues that that we need to think about in every country, wherever we find ourselves in. You know, policies need to be in place, again, proactively. And it sounds like if there were a policy to integrate people smoothly, then, you know, you wouldn't be faced with a situation where you have a large number of undocumented or irregular immigrants not knowing, you know, how to support them in such a crisis. So I think it's the necessity to have policies in place that are informed by, as you say, lived experience and the diversity within lived experiences. And I actually liked what you said about letting them speak, you know, and give their reasons. You know, that more ethnographic, again, people-centered approach, yes. And putting a face to policy, which I think has been missed. And again, this is my only, I absolutely understand the necessity for population studies, but I guess my concern as an anthropologist has always been that oftentimes numbers miss the personal story. And you understand where I'm coming from.
Of course, one person dying is a tragedy, a million people dying is a statistic. Well,
yes.
In the epidemiology and public health, we understand this. I mean, as a, if I can just defend that, my own field of epidemiology, which tends to deal with, it's driven by numbers. If there's enough mm-hmm. outcomes in a population, we can study that population. Mm-hmm. But if a population has to be quite large to generate an outcome. So mm-hmm. probably the mortality rate for COVID-19 is 0.5%. So you need 200 cases to generate one death. Yeah. So if we have a population that's quite small, which is only going to get 200 cases anyway, mm-hmm. very hard to study. It's impossible to study epidemiologically. Yes. You could study it in other ways. But so that's why epidemiologists tend to aggregate their populations until the populations are large enough to yield the number of outcomes you require. For mm-hmm. population studies in epidemiology, we normally want about 400 outcomes mm-hmm. to generate robust, statistically robust conclusions. So to generate 400 outcomes, we normally need quite a large population.
Yes, yes.
That's why we don't do it, because we don't understand the nuances mm-hmm. of grouping populations. We do, but yes. we do it out of a practical necessity to have large enough populations that generate. Now, if I can now come back to something we were discussing a little while ago, will we be able to explain these variations? Mm. And if I can just turn back to the current view that's being promoted, that is that people of African origins living in the UK, African Caribbeans, and other African origin populations, people might call them black populations, mm-hmm. they have roughly a doubling of mortality. That's incorrect. It's a fourfold. It's more than fourfold. Now, if you say it's more than fourfold, the first thing you have to do is you have to say, well, we'll adjust for age. Age is such an important factor. Mm-hmm. Having adjusted for age, if it's fourfold.
And geography, probably.
And we shouldn't adjust for geography.
Oh, interesting. The
whole point.
Okay.
We should, you adjust for age and you adjust for sex. I think people would say, well, that's nothing we can do a lot for. Or we can just analyze the data for men and women separately. Mm. Let's say in men, it's fourfold. Now, then, why is it fourfold? I mean, there will be explanations. One of the explanations is poverty. Mm. But it doesn't get away from the fact it's fourfold. There's fourfold numbers of deaths in that community. You can't get away from it. You can try and hide it, but you can't get away from it. Mm. Something needs to be done. One explanation is because of the place they live. But that is not an excuse. Mm-hmm. So we actually adjust for geography, or we adjust for socioeconomic standing, or we adjust for whatever we want to adjust for. And then statistically, we show that the risk goes from fourfold to twofold. Mm-hmm. That doesn't get away from the fact that the risk was fourfold. Now, we've adjusted for it, so we've now got an explanation, a partial explanation, or a potential explanation. Potential explanation being the kind of locality they live in, or the poverty, or the work. It's an explanation. Mm-hmm. It then gives us a way to intervene, mm-hmm. to do something about it. Now, to what that is also telling us when you adjust for geography is telling us that the people who are not African origin in that locality they also have a very high risk.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that they have a very high risk. Now, let's say we put in 10 factors that we know about, we can get the data on, we put them into our model, and we find that once we put them into the model, the risk is twofold. That still leaves a lot to explain.
Mm-hmm.
Now, either the factors we put into the model weren't measured properly, and therefore that adjustment isn't a good adjustment or an accurate adjustment, that if we had measured the variables better, we might have explained more.
Precisely.
Yes. Or there's some other factors that we haven't yet included. And of course, I know that this Public Health England report is being prepared. In fact, mm-hmm. I've been invited to participate in early hearings of the findings. So I'm very much looking forward to hearing what's going to happen,
mm-hmm.
What they're going to find. Professor Kevin Fenton is leading that work.
Where is this being led? Where is the study being led?
Professor Kevin Fenton is the leader of this study on behalf of Public Health England.
Right, okay.
And it's a very high level piece of work, and mm-hmm. I know it's being prepared at the moment. So I can't say any more about it because I don't know any more about it. I will learn about it, and in due course, maybe we'll try and interpret mm-hmm. it. But so let's say we found some explanations, we managed to reduce the risk after adjusting in our model,
mm-hmm.
and we get it down, then it still leaves the question, what about the rest? Now, obviously, some of the rest might be to do with coexisting diseases, heart disease or diabetes or respiratory disorders. Some of it might be to do with lifestyles, eating or being overweight or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And one explanation I've been very interested in is, and I can't say it's a fact, the possibility mm-hmm. that you might be infected with a large dose. If you have been discussing with this elsewhere,
yeah.
the amount of, the dose of the infection you get, the number mm-hmm. of viral particles, it must be important.
And it hasn't been measured yet, to my knowledge.
That's a very difficult issue,
yes.
Scientifically. We don't even know what the infective dose is at the moment, never mind how to measure it.
Mm.
But with any part, we know it's not one. It's not one virus. One virus is not enough to cause you the infection. You need to mm-hmm. have quite a large number of viruses, live viruses, managing to get into your body and mm-hmm. get into your cells before you'll get infected. But what that number is, we're not clear at this point. But if you're living in the kind of life that many of the ethnic minority populations and the migrant populations are living in, they're living in small houses, larger
mm-hmm. number of people,
etc. They might be getting infected from several people at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And they might be getting collectively a large infective dose.
That's
so that could
actually, if I may add, Raj, to this point, was just working on a piece on the religious life of the Ethiopian and Eritrean Orthodox community here in the UK, and obviously church services were still happening early in the year. I can't remember when exactly they stopped. It was April, I believe, when the lockdown was decided. But you know, there is this assumption, it's a speculation, that some spread might have happened within the church, through the church services. And of course, this applies to many other groups that have, you know, religious practices and or other religious cultural practices. They're not differentiated necessarily. So, you know, it's also the lifestyle of the different groups that we need to account for and think how these might create
very
this.
Much so. I mean, shaking hands is thought to be a Western sort of European tradition, but in the Indian communities, certainly in the Indian communities, and certainly amongst my friends who are Pakistanis or Muslims, mm-hmm. Bangladeshis, when we walk into a room, anytime, no matter what the circumstance, whether it's work, party, mm-hmm. golf, wherever in the street, we shake hands vigorously, the men do, with each other.
Mm.
We hold each other's hands for a long time when we shake the hands, and we do it. If there's 100 people in the room, we'll go around the room shaking 100 hands. It's just the culture, it's building relationships.
Precisely.
The women don't always behave that way in our society, but they have their own ways of behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And it does mean close contact. When I meet my white Scottish friends, we don't shake hands in that way.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a culture. If we're meeting in a business setting, yes, we will shake hands as we get introduced, but in a social setting, we don't. So it is odd. If I go to a party where there's a lot of my white Scottish friends there and a lot of my Indian friends or Pakistani friends, the South Asians all shake each other's hands, but the others don't. So you know, there are cultural things. I don't know whether this is relevant, but it might be. The close-knitness of everything, how close people are.
And it also becomes a resource also, right, in this crisis, that you have some support systems, even, you know, you're not, might be well integrated in the whole society for whatever reason, you know, you might not resort to the health services, you might not know resort to the health services, but you have your community that support.
Well, Greeks are like the Indians as well, aren't they?
They are quite expressive.
When you meet people who are from Albania or from Greece and they recognize you as being a Greek, there will be a very special bond. A warmth and a bond will be developing, and it develops very quickly. And similarly, when I'm walking around the street, if I go into a newsagent and the newsagent is, it doesn't have to be Indian, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, I know that Sri Lankan, I know I'm going to be getting a lot of interest from that newsagent.
Exactly. It is a community.
We talk to each other, we shake each other's hands, so the newsagent wouldn't shake anyone else's hands, their other customers' hands, but they'll come into a conversation with me and they recognize I'm Indian and they maybe speak a Punjabi word or something they can recognize. Yeah. And then I speak back and then they'll shake my hand.
Yes,
it's so bonds develop.
Yes, absolutely. And I always, having done a bit of econometrics, you know, I'm thinking of a multi-variable regression, how you would fit all the possible variables to account for when you think of all the possible factors, you know, informing one's susceptibility to a crisis. So, Raj, this was highly informative. I've learned so much from you.
Can I leave you with one message, Romina?
I was about to invite the final word from you.
Okay. Well, thank you for that. I just want to leave a final word that by and large, the ethnic minority populations and the migrant populations, wherever they are, but certainly in the UK, they're in very good form. They're full of energy. They're youthful. They're able. They're contributing. They want to contribute. And they're in pretty good health. I mean, yes, there are specific issues where there are definitely matters of concern. For example, in type 2 diabetes is a matter of concern for virtually all the ethnic minority groups in the UK, except for the Chinese. But even there, it's coming on. But by and large, when it comes to life expectancy, cancer, they're doing incredibly well. And for many other outcomes, they're doing incredibly well. Yeah. So it's swings and roundabouts. Some things the minorities are doing really well in, sometimes some things they're not doing so well in, but overall it's pretty good. No, the communities are not falling apart.
Yes, and thank you for nuancing the narrative. Time to change the narrative and nuance it a bit, you know, and think more open-mindedly and differently. So thank you so much, Raj Bhopal.
Thank you so much.
Raj Bhopal from the University of Edinburgh. Stay safe, stay well, and all the best.
It's been a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much.
All the best. Bye.
Bye-bye.